Hello friends, nice meeting you again. Welcome back. Hope you are all doing good. And this video is about the second part of the load measurements. And in the previous video, we covered about the need of the load measurements, the standard that governs the load measurements, the instrumentation technique that needs to be done or implemented to carry out mechanical load measurements on a wind turbine. And then what are the measurement parameters that one needs to consider to do a load measurement campaign, starting from the mid parameters to the electrical parameters and finally the mechanical parameters, and the special instrumentation technique, which is the strain gauging, which needs to be done to measure the bending moments and the forces. So we also covered briefly about how the strain gauge works and what is the principle behind it, which is the Wheatstone bridge. So next to that, we also covered about the measurement load cases. Like we have the design load cases from the aeroelastic simulation standard, which talks about various scenarios that you need to simulate your turbine. And similarly here, when it comes to mechanical load measurements, you also need to measure certain conditions of the certain behavior of the wind turbine on certain conditions. That is called as the measurement load cases. So from that, from the measurement load cases, we will now see what are the other topics that other aspects to be covered in the mechanical load measurements till the reporting stage, and finally the load validation. So come on, let's get into the video. And as usual, I have a skeleton here so that we don't miss any key points here. So this is what we covered last video, which is about the instrumentation and the strain gauging, and the measurement parameters, which is about the parameters mentioned here, starting from the mid parameters, from the mid mast, which is wind speed, pressure, wind direction, humidity, temperature, and so. And then you have the electrical quantities measured from the control panel, and mechanical parameters are mainly the blade root loads, the edge and the flap moments. And from the shaft is the three loads, which is the X bending, Y bending, and the shaft torsion, which is the mechanical power basically. And then you need to measure the rotor top loads, where you have the tip moment, the yaw moments, and then finally the tower top torsion. And then here you have the tower bottom loads. Here it is two loads, one is the tip moment, the other is the lateral moment. So which is basically the main load that acts on the foundation is the tower bottom load. So this is about the mechanical loads, electrical loads, and the electrical parameters, and then the mid parameters. So this is all about the measurement parameters that you need to measure or plan in the measurement campaign. And then here comes the measurement load cases. Okay, now you have established the measurement setup, and now you want to know what are the measurements that you need to carry out. Now you have all the sensors mounted on the midmast and the tower and on the blades, etc. And now you are also connected to the PC, which is the data acquisition system. And typically the sampling frequency for such a measurement is 1 Hz, which is again governed by the standard. So that's how you collect the samples. And now you have all the measurement setup ready, and now comes the measurement types, which is the measurement load cases. So you have two type of measurements basically. One is the continuous measurement. You have to collect all the data, all the sample from the low wind to the high wind period. So which is basically 3 to 4 months in a high wind period. If you start collecting all the information, you'll have from the lowest wind speed bend to the highest bend. And as per the standard, it is VR plus 2 meters per second is basically the high wind speed that is needed to conclude on a load measurement campaign. VR is the rated wind speed plus 2. So this is the essential wind speed at the high wind condition that you need to measure for the continuous measurements, so that you can conclude, okay, I have enough data to look at the analysis of the load measurement. So that's the VR plus 2 criteria. So that's about the continuous measurement. You have to keep measuring all the parameters continuously with the sampling frequency of minimum 1 Hz. And second one is about the transient measurement. So these transient measurements are where you trigger something on your control panel, like you do a normal stop, you do an emergency stop, you do a grid shutdown trigger, maybe you just do a trigger from the transformer yard, so which creates a grid shutdown condition, and then do an overspeeding simulation. So all this you need to do from the controller, wherein you have to monitor how the turbine behaves at a given wind speed. So that's about the transient measurement. And each one of this transient measurement, like normal stop, emergency stop, is again related to the DLC of the IEC 61400-01. So like I told in the beginning, so when we did the simulations according to IEC 61400-01 standard, so we had several DLCs. For power production, normal power production loading, we have 1.2 as the DLC. For power production loading with occurrence of fault, which is DLC 2.2 and 2.1, so which talks about the normal stop and emergency stop. No, that's about the power production with occurrence of fault. And for the stop conditions, we have DLC 3.1 and 3.2 and so on. So all these are the transient events, and 1.2 corresponds to continuous measurement. So, and that is again related to a similar MLC number. So that's how the measurement process that you need to carry on. And next comes the database fulfillment criteria. Okay, so once you started with the measurement, you also need to know how, when to conclude. So that's where we have the criteria coming in. So in case of IEC 61400-12-1 for power curve measurements, we had this database validation or database fulfillment criteria, which talked about the 1.5 times the VREF, and where VREF is nothing but the wind speed at which the machine achieves 85% of the rated power. So that's about 1.5 times VREF, and here we have VR plus 2 is the highest wind speed that you need to measure. And further to that, you also need to satisfy a criteria which is again based on the wind speed. And in case of power curve measurements, you divided the wind speed bin into 0.5 bin intervals. Here you have to divide it in terms of 1 meters per second bin intervals. And again, on the other hand, you also need to segregate or filter or divide the data with respect to turbulence intensity bins again. So on the turbulence intensity bins are 2%. So you have a matrix like TA values with 2% intervals, and on the other hand, on the other axis, you have wind speed bins. So this is called the capture matrix, and in every box of this particular TA and this particular wind speed, you need to have certain number of database in it. So certain hours of measurement needs to be there inside this each bin. So this is called the complete capture matrix for a continuous measurement load measurement campaign. And again, similarly for transient measurements, you again have different capture matrices. Like you need to do 2 times of normal stop in an operating wind condition, and 3 times of emergency stop in a low wind condition, and 2 times of one blade locked test. So there are certain number of trials that you need to repeat for this transient events, which is again governed by the corresponding capture matrices for the transient measurements. So that's how the database fulfillment criteria is maintained here. And finally comes, okay, now you concluded the data, that you have enough data set to work on the analysis for the continuous and the transient measurements. And then next comes how the data analysis is carried out. So when it comes to data analysis, I would classify basically the load measurement analysis takes part in 3 directions. One is the statistical analysis, the other is the equivalent load analysis, and the other one is the time series analysis. And each one boils down to different results. Like the statistical analysis is basically plotting the scatter plots or the bin graphs for the mechanical parameters. So you basically have wind speed versus edgewise bending moment, wind speed versus flockwise bending moments, wind speed versus shaft loads, wind speed versus tower loads. So that's how you do the statistical analysis from the lowest wind speed to the highest wind speed. So this is just a spread or the statistical plot of looking at the mechanical parameters. So that is about the statistical values. And then the equivalent loads is something which I will explain here. So this equivalent load is mainly used to, this statistical load is mainly used to understand the extreme loads. So when we talk about mechanical loads, we have 2 type of loads. One is the extreme loading, which is the impact loads, and the fatigue loads, which is about the cyclic loads or the operational loads. So therefore, so we need to do 2 type of analysis. The statistical one, which gives an idea about what is the extreme load happening on the every component here. And the equivalent load helps us to measure or helps us to calculate from the measurements. It helps us to calculate the equivalent load, the fatigue load for every component for different mechanical properties, which is actually the M value, which is the slope value. So on how the equivalent load is calculated from the measured load, which is the statistical measurement, is basically by this process called rainflow counting. And this is and again, you have different type of rainflow counting techniques, and what IEC talks about is a simple rainflow counting method. That's the process here. Consider a time series like this, which is typically for a 10 minutes period, and assume this is a tau bottom signal, tau bottom bending moment, and this is how the deflection happens. So this is the mechanical behavior, mechanical bending behavior of the tower here. And if someone asks you what is the mechanical load that acted on this particular tower bottom for the last 10 minutes, you cannot answer with one particular number. So what you have to basically give is the plot like this, and you have to tell a range, okay, plus or minus 200 kilonewton meter is the range of the load that acted for the last 10 minutes, and it acted like this in a stochastic manner. So this is how you only have to define it. But that's not easy if you're measuring for a long period, for 4 months, and if you want to say what kind of load is happening here in terms of the fatigue loads, then you cannot every time give a graph like this. So that's where you have the equivalent load representation, which is the name itself talks of equivalent load. So which means what kind of impact that this stochastic load would have created on this particular component is represented in a different form like this. So instead of having a time series like this, which is more stochastic in nature, if the load happened in this way, let's say this is a mean value of 70 kilonewton meters, instead of the load varying from this shape, if 70 kilonewton meter is applied on this particular component with a frequency of 1 hertz, 1 cycle per second. So if I apply 70 kilonewton meter 1 cycle per second for 600 seconds, the same impact of what this load would have created will be created with this load. So therefore, then I have a known number of cycles. What is the cycle? What is the loading occurred? So I have number of cycles which is known to me, and S is the stress level, which is this 70 kilonewton, the less stress level, and then you have the slope number. And for every mechanical every material, there is a mechanical property, and that's where the M comes in, which is the slope value and the behavior, which represents the behavior of that material. If it is steel, then you have a slope value of, let's say, M equal to 8 or 10. And for glass fibers, if you are studying the fatigue load on the blade, then you have to apply different M value. So that's how you can calculate the fatigue loads, and this fatigue load is also calculated for all the mechanical parameters for different slope values corresponding to the mechanical property. So that is also done here. And then comes the time series analysis, which is about studying or observing the natural frequency of the components. What is the natural frequency of the blade? What is the natural frequency of the rotor shaft and natural frequency of the tower? So this is calculated basically from a given time series, and then you have to convert this time series into a frequency domain plot like this, where you have 1 by F and the F versus F, and here you have the maximum peak occurring here, which represents the natural frequency of the particular component. Assume this is from the tower bottom. And for the tower bottom, a signal like this, if you convert it to a frequency domain plot using power spectral density analysis, then you have a graph like this, and the first highest peak which represents here is basically the natural frequency of the tower. So like that you can calculate or transform, you can obtain the natural frequency by transforming the time series of clockwise bending moment of the blade, and also the shaft bending moment of the rotor. If you use it, and then you can easily find out the natural frequency of those components. So that's how all the three are obtained, and these are basically the output of a load measurement campaign. So from that, what we do is actually this is all about the load measurements, and this part is about the next step, which gives the completeness of a load measurement campaign. So once the results are available, then what we do, the certification body or the designer, what they do is a process called load validation. And here they compare the measurement results with the simulations. So the aeroelastic simulations according to one standard, what we did, which is about the DLCs. The results from the DLCs are compared one-to-one over plotted with the measurements here. So this is a simple example where I have shown a power curve comparison of a measurement versus simulation. Like that you have to do for all the parameters, main parameters like blade, shaft, the tower loads. So for all this, you have to compare both the statistical values as well as the equivalent loads. So you need to compare the measurement versus simulation, and you have to see how best these two are correlated. And if the deviations are too much, then it is a big problem that you have to either tune your controller here, or you have to remodel your aeroelastic simulation code. So it goes in an iteration. But typically we have seen more or less the measurement falls within the limits, and then there is a high correlation between the measurements and the simulation, and then this gives a high confidence to the designer who used the aeroelastic code to do the complete simulation of all the DLCs and design the turbine. So that's how the load validation is done. And then after seeing this, finally the type certification body issues a type certificate, because he gains confident by seeing the measurement versus the design, and then he feels okay, this is the right turbine and it performs to what it is designed for, and then finally they give a type certificate. So that's how the whole process of load measurements is done, and finally how this is how it helps the certification body to finally issue a type certificate. I think with this we will conclude this session of the load measurements video. And we will see you in the next video with a very good topic. And if you have any doubts in this, you can feel free to raise your comments in the comment section, or maybe write a personal email to me. My email is also visible in the description part, so you can respond and then ask your queries. I will be happy to respond to you. So thank you again, and thanks for watching all my videos. And please feel free to pass it on to useful friends who might find this interesting. And see you again. Till then, it's bye from Coombs.